When I was young, I struggled knowing how much cologne was, well, enough. Just finishing up a workout and you raise your arms to pick up your bag when, ugh, is that me? You pull out your deodorant from your bag, level it against your stinky pits. But wait, how much is too much? It's not that big of a deal, right? I mean, it's not like anyone's ever died from too much deodorant, right? When Louise Capewell found her son Jonathan unconscious on the floor of his bedroom, she didn't know what to think, let alone when she learned that he'd suffered a heart attack. But what could have triggered this deeply tragic development? How did a young man go from spray to pray? Let's get into it. Today's episode of Brew is sponsored by Skillshare. Skillshare is an online community dedicated to learning and broadening our horizons. With thousands of classes, Skillshare is a great place for people who want to discover their creativity and learn new skills. Seriously, is there something you've always wanted to do but never knew how to get started? Skillshare is the best place to hit the ground running. Whether it's photography, social media, and even indoor vegetable gardening, you can find classes to help you achieve your goals. We've been going through all of Thomas Frank's Productivity for Creatives lecture series lately, and it's really helping build the mindset to really do your best. People think creativity is something you're born with, but no, it's something you create. It's super low stakes, and you can take it at your own pace, which is nice for students and working professionals alike. And hey, even if you don't want to learn a new skill right now, Skillshare also carries resources for self-care and wellness, including classes like The Ultimate Self-Care Playbook by Jonathan Van Ness and Writing for Self-Discovery by Yasmin Cheyenne. Skillshare is ad-free, and new premium classes launch every week. Oh, and did I mention that Skillshare's entire catalog is now available with subtitles in Spanish, French, Portuguese, even German, the language of love? Click the link in the description. The first 1,000 people to use the link will get a 1-month free trial of Skillshare. While Axe body spray didn't arrive on US store shelves until 2002, it appeared in European pharmacies since 1983. When the sharp smell of the spray hit UK shelves, it did so under the name Lynx. The world of aerosol sprays wasn't new. Cans of hairspray littered the backpacks of stylish teens and hairdressers for 40 years. But this was something new. Axe and Lynx alone have a global retail value of about $1.4 billion. In the UK alone, the brand had about 8 million users as of 2020. So, needless to say, there's something about that sweet spray we just can't get enough of. Then, one day in 1998, 16-year-old boy Jonathan Capewell was found dead from a heart attack in his home in Oldham, a borough just east of Manchester in the United Kingdom. According to his family, he was obsessed with smelling fresh and had a routine of spraying his entire body with deodorant twice a day. Jonathan's father said that, when we told him he was using too much, he said he just wanted to smell good. It got to the point that even when the rest of the family were downstairs, we couldn't just smell it, we could taste it. Investigating afterwards, Jonathan's parents found cans of Lynx, Right Guard, and Gillette in his bedroom. Sue Rogers of the British Aerosol Manufacturing Association said that, "It is extraordinarily unusual and terribly tragic. The aerosols have warnings about spraying in confined areas and well-ventilated places, but these are for flammability risks, not about accidental inhalation." Barry Williams, the local coroner, recorded Jonathan's death as accidental. The post-mortem noted that he had 0.37 milligrams of butane and the same amount of propane per liter in his blood, when just 0.1 milligram per liter can be fatal. Jonathan's death was believed to be the first by accidental inhalation in the UK. Williams, the coroner, noted that there wasn't any reason to think he was abusing aerosols, but instead, the case was a high use of deodorant. His personal hygiene led him to use more than was normal in a confined space which limits ventilation. In terms of intentional inhalation of aerosols, about 220 deaths have been attributed to inhalant abuse between 2015 to 2020. But what about aerosols, specifically spray-on deodorant, is so dangerous? Firstly, we should talk about what actually is in spray deodorant. Jonathan's parents found cans of Lynx, the UK brand name for Axe, Right Guard, and Gillette. So while ingredients may change from product to product and year by year, it still serves us to know what's in them. Lynx spray, according to their website, contains butane and propane. Gillette Invisible Spray contains butane. Right Guard spray contains butane and propane. So, Jonathan Capewell was found with high concentrations of propane and butane. And if we look at those ingredients, we see that those same two substances are common among all three. But what are they doing in deodorant sprays anyway? You may be familiar with propane already. It's primarily used for heating and cooking, aka, it's a flammable gas. If you've ever been to a neighborhood barbecue party or gone camping, then you might recognize the tanks that store the gas. But what about butane? The number one use of butane is as a flammable fuel. The most common places you'd see this gas in action is in those little cigarette lighters they sell at gas stations and in small tanks for camping stoves. If you've seen the hairspray lighter trick, then it's not unsurprising that spray deodorant could also contain flammable fuels. But why even use flammable gases in deodorant? Couldn't spray deodorants use compressed air? You know, the stuff that comes in cans that you use to clean out your keyboards or dust off old corners of your office. In canned air, carbon dioxide is pressurized in a liquid form, with the evaporated CO2 gas sitting at the top ready for use. This is why using a can of compressed air upside down shoots out cold liquid, because the CO2 is mostly liquid, save for the top. As you use compressed air, it cools rapidly, which slows down evaporation, therefore reducing the pressure, a process called adiabatic cooling. Butane and propane, however, have a much higher vapor pressure than plain old CO2, so they're much more efficient over time. As you use your spray, the vapor propels the contents out, reducing pressure inside the can, and the liquid evaporates, repressurizing the space. So that's why flammable gases are used for propellants. But that still doesn't tell us how spray deodorant could trigger heart problems like Jonathan's heart attack. Maybe another case will help us understand. The story of Thomas Townsend, a 16-year-old from Kent who passed away in 2016, is similar to Jonathan's. Thomas's mother, Sally, said that her son would replace showers with spray deodorant, and he would go through a can per week. When authorities searched his room, they found 42 assorted cans of spray. The Environmental Working Group, an organization that researches harmful chemicals, has rated many common body sprays and deodorants as potentially harmful. Axe and Old Spice, they say, are moderate to high health hazards. The coroner, who examined Thomas post-mortem, found that he died due to a collapse of the circulatory system due to butane gas inhalation. So clearly, there's some connection between the inhalation of butane and propane and heart problems. But what could it possibly be? Well, high concentrations of any particular gas is pretty much always bad. Even breathing air with too high a concentration of oxygen can be dangerous for you, even kill you. Normal air contains about 21% oxygen, 78% nitrogen, and 1% other random gas. Jonathan and Thomas sprayed their deodorant indoors, and with the lack of ventilation, butane and propane must have built up in the air around them, forcing them to breathe those gases. So, what happens when you breathe them in? Let's start with propane. Propane is a colorless and odorless gas, made as a byproduct of the refinery process. It's also used as a part of liquefied petroleum gas. In a study looking to see the effects of propane inhalation, using the National Advisory Committee for Acute Exposure Guideline Levels for Hazardous Substances, found that after 10 minutes of exposure to propane at 10,000 parts per million, volunteers felt nothing. After 2 minutes at 100,000 ppm, however, all volunteers felt distinct vertigo. In a second test made on beagles, researchers exposed them to various levels of propane for 5 minutes while injecting them with epinephrine to monitor whether or not their hearts suffered sensitization, a test to see if propane made them more susceptible to heart attacks and other cardiovascular injuries or issues. None of the six dogs had any heart issues at 50,000 ppm. 2 out of 12 dogs had some issues at 100,000 ppm. And 7 of 12 showed cardiac sensitization at 200,000 ppm. The results seem simple enough. The higher the concentration of propane, the more sensitive you are to heart failure. However, the study does note that most fatal cases of propane intoxication are due to oxygen deprivation. Propane replaces oxygen in an enclosed space, so you'd keep breathing like normal, but slowly your brain would start being deprived of oxygen. This also accounts for the sense of vertigo, as the main 5 symptoms of hypoxia, aka oxygen deprivation, are lightheadedness, dizziness, mental confusion, visual impairment, and tingling. According to Medline, propane takes the place of oxygen in your lungs, which can make it difficult to get the oxygen your body needs. Remember when we learned that normal air contains about 21% oxygen and the rest is inert gas? Well, using too much spray deodorant in an unventilated room can shift the ratio of oxygen to gas in an enclosed space, slowly depriving your brain of oxygen, leading to all sorts of bad news. So, could it be butane that took the lives of these young men? Much like propane, butane is created from natural gas, and as a byproduct of the refining process, its effects on the body are actually well documented. Butane operates as a central nervous system depressant, which means that it depresses brain activity, which is not necessarily bad. Prescription drugs that act the same way include Valium, Xanax, and Ambien, among others. The issue with butane is that the fumes are absorbed into the bloodstream rapidly. Not only that, the chemicals are fat-soluble, which means they're able to pass into the brain and other organs easily. So, the effects of inhalation take hold quickly. The long-term effects of butane inhalation include chronic headaches, nosebleeds, chronic coughs, depression, anxiety, tinnitus, ringing in the ears, ataxia, loss of muscle coordination, shortness of breath, and sinus infections. On top of that, butane has long-term health impacts like kidney, liver, and brain damage, as well as chemical burns, seizures, and visual impairment that can become permanent. Addiction is also possible. However, according to drugs.ie, a support resource from the government of Ireland, dependence is typically psychological rather than physical. In short, there's basically nothing good that can come from it. You should only ever use spray aerosols in well-ventilated spaces and in modest amounts. Most aerosol sprays have warnings on the label for exactly that reason. Now, if all of those symptoms aren't enough to convince you this is bad news, there's also SSDS, or sudden sniffing death syndrome. Butane fume inhalation can cause cardiac arrhythmia, in which the heart starts beating irregularly. Then, if the person who has been exposed experiences excitement or starts physical activity, the heart can fail to pump blood, triggering a heart attack. Not only is SSDS a very real threat to your life, the other symptoms can also cause fatal accidents like choking on one's vomit, suffocation, and explosions due to the flammability of the gas. So then, knowing what we know now, what happened to Thomas and Jonathan? Both young men experienced cardiac issues, and while we can't be sure what exactly happened to them, it's most likely that they inhaled unhealthy amounts of butane and propane after using too much spray deodorant in a poorly ventilated space. After that, they probably started to feel some of the negative effects of the chemicals, and likely triggered a heart attack after experiencing cardiac sensitization or SSDS. The bottom line is that we lost them, and we can't get them back. I don't want you to come away from this episode thinking spray deodorant is bad and dangerous, because it isn't. It can be dangerous under the right circumstances, but thankfully, those circumstances are pretty easy to avoid. Always use spray deodorant in small quantities and in well-ventilated spaces. Like Jonathan's mother said following his death, you just get up in the morning and spray it on. But who expects it to kill you? It's not knowing what makes something dangerous that makes us vulnerable to it. In a world that can only get more complicated, understanding is our greatest protection. Click the link in the description. The first 1,000 people to sign up through our link will get you a 1-month free trial of Skillshare.